Joining us.
Oh, man.
You're on. We're rolling. Eddie Pepitone, my muse, my beloved Eddie. My beloved Eddie, how are you, sir?
Oh, hi, David. How are you, buddy? You're at the... We miss you over here on the West Coast.
Thank you.
We need some people who read over here. There's not many readers, as you know, on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm. And most of them
they
are writing. Most of them are writing for television.
Yeah.
So Eddie,
what's going on with the writer's strike? By the way, do we want to talk about that at all?
I will talk about the writer's strike. Anything to shut Hollywood down is a good thing. Anything that just stops TV is a good thing.
Yeah. It probably is, right?
Well, the country is completely effed, Eddie Pepitone. I know that you voted for Trump.
I know
you have this act where you're the disenchanted.
Well, I wanted to shake things up. How about the people who say that? Like, I voted for Trump just to shake things up. Oh, you mean to open up public lands for exploration? I heard Mark Maron, I'm a regular at the Comedy Store now, not to brag, but I heard Maron say on stage, so it looks like hunting in zoos will be legal soon.
So tell me what you've been up to. Have you been traveling? Well, we'll talk about politics in a second. It's been a while. Last time you did the show, you were calling as a pretend Trump supporter. So tell me some good news.
Yeah.
Let's start with some good news. Tell me good news.
Good news.
I want five good things. Five good things.
Oh, you know, for me, that's hard.
No, it isn't.
My wife's car started up right away today, and we were afraid it wouldn't. That's
good.
Number one.
Good.
Basil and Charlotte are very well. They run after squirrels. It's just a beautiful thing. We have a nice green big park here that also serves as a homeless encampment, but the park itself, you know, you can't look. Any public space in the United States now is teeming with homeless people because of, you know, the deindustrialized nightmare that the United States has become because corporations are allowed. By the way, this is funny that this is on my list of good things. I can't help but getting into it. But yeah,
you're absolutely right. There was an article by an MIT professor. He has a new book out.
Noam Chomsky?
Noam
Chomsky.
I want to get him on the show. He has a new book out. 80% of Americans are in debt and are suffering from job insecurity. He said that fits the model for a third world nation. When 80% of a population are racking up debt and are experiencing job insecurity and fear, it's the model for a third world nation. So,
well, we know that that's the case. That it is true. It really is very starkly. It's haves and have nots, and it's gotten scarier, which I didn't think was possible with this administration, and just the absolute disregard for people in debt and, you know, on the edge and all that stuff. What? How about you? Are you scared? I mean, the other three things that are going well for me is that I'm a paid regular at the Comedy Store, and I've been doing a ton of sets, and I was always scared to do the Comedy Store. I was always kind of intimidated by
it. Adam now. He's
Adam. You're right. Adam Egitt is just a doll, and he's changed the vibe there. It's a real happening place. So every night I've been performing in front of huge crowds, and really growing as a stand-up.
That's great.
And then I've been working three times a week with a personal trainer. But the funny thing about that is that my cholesterol, it's good but not great. And he tells me, I've been working three times a week with a personal trainer for almost a year, and I just had a physical for the first time in about this, you know, a year or whatever. And he said, you have to diet and exercise. So I don't know what the hell I'm doing wrong with that.
The Comedy Store, that's great news. I did the Comedy Store. I could not pass Mitzi. She wouldn't pass me.
She wouldn't pass me either.
Yeah, so I just, is she there? Who was that? And what happened to me? Anyway, I don't want to talk about me. Anyway, but I was back there, and Adam is like the great, you know, he's taking over. Go look at Norm MacDonald's YouTube television show. Adam is his sidekick on it. They don't make them anymore.
I know.
And he would read jokes to Norm. There's one episode with Super Dave that might be one of the funniest things I've ever seen in my life. Adam reading these horrible jokes to Super Dave, and Super Dave is just yelling. So that's great news. That's great news about the comedy store.
Yes, it's good for me. Yeah. I've been traveling a little. I'm going to Atlanta in June to film. I'm a regular on this Adult Swim show called Your Pretty Face is Going to Hell.
With Craig Rowan.
We're filming a new season. Yes, your buddy Craig Rowan. He's a big part of that show. Henry Zebrowski, Matt Servito, who was a regular on The Sopranos as a DA agent who used to chase Tony. Real funny guy, really nice guy. Anyway, so I'm going to Atlanta. And last time I was in Atlanta, from my hotel balcony, there was a huge protest trying to get onto Interstate. I think it's Interstate 80 out there. And right from my balcony, I saw this standoff between protesters and the cops. It was the time last summer when it was all about the cops shooting people and stuff like that. I was in the middle of that in Atlanta from my balcony.
That's better than Spankavision. Who needs to rent porn when you can watch protesters and cops in Atlanta, of all places?
Let's
discuss what's going on in the world, because in the past, you've come on the show and complained about how bad things are. And I've always agreed with you, but I kept it to myself. And I would say, but Eddie, we need to be positive. We need to be upbeat. We can't let our listeners wallow in self-pity. So what did we do? We got to three good things in your life. Your wife's car turned over. You have two dogs who chase squirrels. And you're performing at the Comedy Store. Okay, maybe, but we'll get to five. I say unto you, Eddie, it's so bad out there in this country, in America. It is so bad. It is so bad.
Why are you saying that? Is this just personal, you know, personal experience, or are you reading and watching particular news reports?
I am telling people things are bad, and they're saying to me, you're letting your demons get a hold of you. You have inner... I don't have inner demons. It sucks. How can life be good when 80% of us are terrified, when you have this, you know, president, and people go, but he doesn't affect... He does. The whole mood of the country is shaped by what's happening in Washington, D.C. You can turn off the news and not pay attention. But it filters down because it's filtering up. Trump is there because it filtered up. It's not filtering down. We ended up with Trump because the disease filtered up and put him into office, and everybody is miserable, and it's a lie. Trump. The whole country is a lie. Everybody's life in America is a lie.
Well, you know who my guru is. It's Chris Hedges, and he puts it, the way he puts the lie is that people retreat. They retreat into fantasy when their reality is too difficult to deal with. And I think that is the lie you're talking about. People are pretending that things are fine. You know what I mean? I'm really way too into my dogs chasing squirrels, for instance.
and you love squirrels. Didn't you like almost beat a guy up because he was throwing rocks at squirrels?
Well, I never... Yeah, I mean, I am a squirrel protector, which is similar to a water protector, except it's squirrels and not water. And there's a few of us in the park who protect squirrels.
Now, where are you now?
I'm in North Hollywood.
No, I'm saying, where are you? I hear like a plate, or what do I hear in the background?
Wow, that was one of your, that's one of your superpowers, is hearing a spoon hit a porcelain bowl. My wife's eating cereal across from me.
Oh, I see. All right, let's go over some
very
of the...
very good hearing.
Let's go over...
Oh, yeah, everything is bad. Trump is a manifestation. By the way, Trump didn't come from... No, Trump didn't come out of the blue. Trump came as a progression. And I don't know if we've talked about this, but I don't think you completely agree with me. Trump is a progression of the corporate coup d'etat that has happened in this country, and the Democrats, and I think me and you have had a little bit of disagreement on this, the Democrats, the corporate Democrats, I call them, and Hedges call them, you know, they sold us out. The Democratic Party sold us out. And since the Democratic Party stopped representing the working man and woman and the middle class, you got Trump, because, you know, the quote-unquote deplorables were taken in by his hucksterism, because they lost faith in the Democratic Party. I don't know if you agree with me or
Absolutely.
Edges, but that's
Absolutely.
What he says.
Absolutely.
They sold this out. I mean, everybody talks about how, you know, I mean, Obama was a very civil guy, but I think, as Jimmy Dore puts it, he was like a very nice, elegant, good-looking face on corporate war and corporate evil. Mm-hmm. And now we have the ugly face.
Absolutely. I do love Obama, because I have to believe in right and wrong, and they give me two options, Republican and Democrat, and I go, okay, Democrats are right, Republicans are wrong, when in fact, they're both wrong.
Yeah, we need, I mean, to me, David, I mean, do you see this coming? I think I mean, this is scary to me, but I think it needs to be done. There's got to be massive unrest here soon, when 80% of the population is in terror, don't you think?
No, I don't. I think that it's a subtle terror. We police ourselves. When you're terrorized, it's mostly we do it to ourselves. We blame ourselves, because we pick up the newspaper and read about the wealthy, and we're obsessed with the wealthy, and we buy into the lie that they deserve to be wealthy, and that they're happy because they're wealthy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
No, I don't think there's going to be massive unrest, because we're a police state. Right?
Well, that's not a good thing, that we're a police state.
But why haven't the African Americans who, you know, the African Americans are saying to me, hey, welcome. How does it feel?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And why haven't African-Americans rose up?
Because of the massive military force, right?
We live in a police state. If you're black, we live in a police state. If you're black in America, we live in a police state. Fact.
Right.
That's a fact.
Right.
It is a
fact.
It is a fact.
That is a fact.
If you're black,
no
this,
doubt.
This is a police state for black men.
Yep.
And because it
but
isn't...
Now
a,
it, yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, and now, you know, people, African Americans are telling you, welcome to their world, right? Because it's now extended to, you know, everybody in poverty.
So there won't be a mass uprising. It'll be a whimper. It's over.
Well, how will things, it's over?
Yeah, the country's over, Eddie.
Yeah,
the fact,
I kind of agree.
When people say to you, how do you think it's going to end? It's over. Get up. Get up. You can leave now. There's a new show about to start, but it's over. Look who's in the White House. It's over.
Yeah.
Why can't, you know, the problem with America is we never admit defeat. We've never lost a war. We can't even say we lost in Iraq. We can't even say we lost in Vietnam. We lost. And guess what?
Afghanistan.
Guess what, folks? Look who's president. It's over. It's over. Accept defeat. It's over. Now what?
Right. Now what? What is that's what I'm asking. I say massive unrest. You say no. So what happens?
I'm creating an app for Americans to pick a new government. It's like it's a Tinder app where you swipe left if you want to reject fascism. Swipe left, Democratic Republic. Swipe right. It's we have to start all over again. It's over.
And if so we need like big grassroots political stuff, huh?
Well, I'd rather hear your opinion, but I will say this. I pissed off a lot of people when I said that the end to Reconstruction was the worst thing that ever happened to this country because the Civil War, we defeated the South. We burnt Atlanta to the ground. And we freed the blacks, and there were more black senators and congressmen representing the South than at any time in American history, especially now. But then there was this unholy deal that we made to get Rutherford B. Hayes into the White House. And the deal was, we'll give you Rutherford B. Hayes, but you have to put an end to Reconstruction. So they ended Reconstruction.
Now, Reconstruction was, explain Reconstruction to me again.
They take hair from the back of my head and they plant it on the top where the hair is missing. And then you wait a couple of months and it grows and it's your hair. And the technology now is nobody can really tell. So that's... Reconstruction was rebuilding the South in our image. The same way we built Germany and Japan in our image. Germany and Japan were the victims of total war after World War II. We mowed them down. I'm not bragging. I'm not getting erect. Well, semi-erect. But America won. Russia won. Britain won that war. And we said to Japan, we said to Germany, say Uncle Sam, say Uncle Sam. And they said Uncle Sam, and we stopped bombing them. And they admitted defeat. It was over. Everything they stood for was wrong. Germany, everything you valued is gone. We're rebuilding you in our image. We're God. Japan will let you keep Hirohito, but we're rebuilding you in our image. And we did, and they surpassed us. If they are the American dream is alive and well in Germany and Japan because they have the values of the greatest generation.
Even in Japan, I thought they're. I know Germany is kind of at the forefront of the economy, right?
Well, Japan, yeah.
But Japan,
they have a social safety net, yeah.
Oh, they do.
Sure, and they're going through a quote-unquote recession. We should only have the type of recession they have in Japan.
Well, I mean, you know, Europe, though, is also, right? Europe is also undergoing economic and, you know, strains of fascism as well, right? Brexit, the French election. I mean, the far right is all over Europe, isn't it, popularly?
Yeah, but are they winning?
I don't really think so.
No.
Right?
No.
But over here,
the
far
right.
So what's going to be over here? What's going to be over here? I don't know.
It's a whimper. It ended with a whimper, not with a bang. Mm. Anybody who is looking at us from afar would say it's over. But there's value to it being over. If we could admit it's over,
right,
then we can rebuild.
What are you saying? What are you saying is over, by the way, specifically? Democracy?
I'm in a bad mood today. Yes, I'm saying the republic is over today. I feel that.
Yeah. What triggered it? The hair, the reconstructive hair.
I think it's like divorce. It's like a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
The person who wants the divorce knows that it's over. The person who doesn't want the divorce doesn't have a clue that it's over. And I think America is a 50-year-old man whose wife has decided it's over, and she has this plan to get out. She has an exit strategy, and the husband is completely oblivious to the plan and doesn't know that the marriage ended when Obama got elected. He thought things were getting better.
Yeah.
But when Obama got elected, she had a plan. Here, pay attention to this constitutional lawyer. But it was over
now,
back
she,
then.
If I'm following the metaphor right, she
yeah.
is the corporate state.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
let's go over the news.
I don't know.
What do you think? What do you think of Kelly Ripa picking Ryan Seacrest to be the co-host? I'm being serious.
The co-host of what?
Live with Kelly. She was doing it. The sister was doing it by herself for about a year.
How do you stay up on that, by the way? How do you stay up on that?
Because it's important, Eddie. It's important. Do you think Ryan...
But I can't even do it in a... Well, I think Ryan Seacrest, not only is he beautiful bone structure-wise, you know, and I think me and you discussed that many times late in the evening, but, you know, he's charming. I'm pretty sure Ryan Seacrest chases squirrels.
But feeds them.
He
chases them to feed them.
No, I don't even... I hate to tell you, that you know, what you're talking about is funny and sad, which is that Americans distract themselves, and it's part of this, you know, the corporate state is... There's never a better time. Like, everybody's talking about the whole country. There's an, you know, there's an eco-genocide happening. There's everybody in debt, and people are talking about the great production values on Game of Thrones. Right?
Yeah.
The rape and pillage on Game of Thrones. And the incredible, beautiful look of the show. I swear to God, people are more interested, and this is what I mean about people retreating into fantasy. Hollywood is a factory of shit.
Okay, you're distracted.
There is hardly...
I want to talk to you about the issues.
Yep.
What about Ellen DeGeneres and Drew Barrymore? Do you think, because as you know...
What's going on? Boy, you're really up on this stuff.
What are you talking about? Ellen runs a show called First Dates, and Drew Barrymore does the voiceovers. Drew
First Dates.
Yeah, it's a great show on television. And Portia Del Rossi is jealous that Ellen is spending more time. What are you laughing at? Do you think Ellen's marriage is in trouble? Do you think she and Portia are going to break up? Is Drew Barrymore? I think she's playing Ellen the same way the other one did. What was her name? Who created her own language? I forgot her name.
Who created her own language? Was that Leakey?
Anne Heche
or Diane Fossey?
Was it Anne
Heche? Diane Fossey and the Gorillas. Oh, Anne Heche.
Remember
she
Anne
created Heche? A language. Oh yeah, didn't she have a nervous breakdown?
Yeah, but
that was what she.
She pretended she was a lesbian and tricked Ellen, and now Drew Barrymore is trying to break up the marriage between Ellen and Portia Del Rossi. Do you think Drew Barrymore is really a lesbian? I mean, she's been married before. Is she pulling an Anne Heche? Yes or no?
Oh, wow. This is really difficult because, you know, this is right up there with the U.S. having the largest prison population in the world.
It is, because what you're saying, and I understand what you're saying, is that Ellen and Portia are trapped in a relationship that resembles a woman's prison.
I didn't even know. I'm really glad we spoke, because I didn't know that Ellen's marriage was in trouble. But now that I do, I am going to put down this Noam Chomsky book, Who Rules the World, and go online and look at this marriage disintegrating. What is Ellen doing? Like, how is Ellen handling it? Who seems to have the upper hand? I mean, that's really kind of the crux of it. Is Ellen okay? That's always my first thought.
I don't know.
When an impending writer's strike, I heard she was so good to the writers. the first time around, I hope she has a solid, you know, a solid family life going on. You don't know what's happening?
I don't know. I don't know what's going on.
Okay,
with
you
Ellen.
Brought it up.
I heard that she's been dating Ellen Page from Juno. Drew Barrymore has been dating Ellen Page from Juno, according to my sources.
I didn't know Drew. So Drew Barrymore is bi? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know. It's just very confusing.
Well,
you keep
throwing out information and then saying, I don't know. So what's going on? Is this fake news you're throwing at me? What are you doing?
No, I would never
do. Are you trying to get me involved in these Hollywood celebrities? What do they call them? Tete-a-tete? You know, the affairs of the rich and famous. Do you remember Robin Leach, by the way? Do you remember
Robin Leach? Champagne wishes and caviar dreams.
How obscene does that seem now with the way the country now it's like in the White House. Welcome to the White House. That's Mar-a-Lago or wherever Trump has his. Welcome to the White House. There is no more visitors log. Oh my God, Robin Leach. Where is he now? Has he taken his life?
No, we try to actually hire him for something, and he wanted to do it, but it was too anti-Trump, and apparently...
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah, he wanted to do it, but then he saw that it was going to be anti-Trump, and I guess he still thinks Trump can butter his bottom.
Yeah.
But, you see, I'm old enough. No, the listeners don't know who Robin Leach was, but he... created the show called Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. When it first came out, it was an obscenity because Reagan had just taken office, and the idea of celebrating wealth in America was so alien to us.
Now, look at it now, where it is a complete country divided into winners and losers, right? It's just winners and losers, and... you know, this whole thing about equating success with material wealth. And, you know, it's really sick. It's really sick.
And it started under Reagan. It started under Reagan.
Yeah, he started dismantling everything. The unions, the air traffic controllers. You know, he started...
And by the way, I'm a member of the Writers Guild, and I'm all for the strike.
What's going on? Yeah, what's going on with that?
Well, what's going on is I think the Writers Guild is perfect, and I love the Writers Guild. However, we're not factory workers. The people shutting down the town are the owners. The Writers Guild.
That's right.
The writers, I'm not. But the people who write television, not movies, but the people who write television, are the owners. They own the shows. So you would have, I mean, the last strike in television, you had guys like Aaron Sorkin striking against themselves.
Oh, really?
They own the shows. The writers own the shows. They were striking.
Well, how do you strike against yourself? That obviously isn't completely true. Well,
they didn't want to spring for lawyers. They're all negotiating these massive deals for themselves, and then they use the union as a cudgel. But as in any union, the only people who benefit from a strike are the top 1%. The rank and file. The rank and file are just marching out of solidarity, but the guys who run the strike are marching because they want their piece of the pie.
I say, like the big showrunners, the big creators.
Yeah, of TV. Yeah. So what they do is it's a lot like war. They'll feed me religion.
Right.
I'm fed religion and solidarity, and we're all in this together.
Right.
So I'll go, okay, D-Day, I'll go, I'll storm the beach.
Yeah.
Because it's for the greater good. The
right.
guy laying back in Dover with the binoculars stands to make $1 billion.
Mm, I see, yeah.
That's
it. Boy, will the world ever change?
No. No.
It won't.
Did I depress you?
No, no. I was, you know, I'm deep into that, deep into depression. much. I now just explore depression as Lewis and Clark once explored this great land.
I'll tell you what triggers a depression for you?
Well, it's hard to say, but for me, my depression takes the form of anxiety. Are you like that? Like, I don't get real, I got some dark, I don't know about where your depression goes to, but I have had a couple of times in my life where, you know, there's that heaviness and, you know, you don't want to move. But mine sort of takes the form of being anxious. And so, you know, I try to combat that with, I have a very large, I'm quilting Ellen right now. Like, I have a quilt and it's Ellen dancing and it just says, and the bottom of it says, get up and dance and don't worry about, you know, the 80%. The 99%. But I get kind of anxious. I'm not sure what triggers it. I think money, status. Am I doing, you know, am I being left behind by, you know, the world? I think a big thing in today's world is you have to feel community with people because the times are very tough. And if you're not connected to a community, I think, you know, that isolation can be very disturbing.
Right. Absolutely.
Do you agree?
Yeah. And I think I'm isolated and I find it depressing.
Yes, it is.
And
I'm just laughing because of the, I think I'm isolated is a very funny sentence if you could step back from it.
Well, I can live my life under the illusion that I'm around people. Because, you know, I'll go out and do stand-up tonight, and I'll be around lots of people tonight.
Right.
But I'm isolated.
Yeah, it's interesting that you can be isolated. Yeah, it's interesting that you can be isolated within. And I think people, you know, that's part of the strategy. I don't know if it's a conscious strategy, but that's part of kind of the technological, development of the land, you know, like the technology has isolated us, I think. You know, the computers, you know, the phones, the laptops, the TVs. It kind of makes everybody a little insular. And then the world seemed to get, you know, people believe that it's a dangerous place. They don't want to leave. They don't want to, you know, explore. You know what I mean? They don't want to go in. They don't want to go into dark alleys. Yesterday, me and my wife walked the two dogs in a dark alley, and it was liberating. It was a little dangerous, but... You know, we came out to tell the tale.
Were the dogs okay? Were they scared?
Well, they're the ones who bring us there. We have a little dog, Basil, who just loves, we don't know what this is, but he loves little alleys. We think he's trying to kill us. he's so small. If you've seen Basil, he's so small and cute. Yet he's always like bringing, you know, the little Muppet, he's always bringing us into these, like, godforsaken places, you know.
He's like Jimmy in Goodfellas saying to Lorraine Bracco, yeah, go in there. Go, the coats are in there. Just walk in there.
Yes. Just but go. We've managed to escape his plot so far. We think he's got he's just got our bank account information and is waiting for us to perish.
Do you let Jimmy from the Goodfellas movie, do you let him lead you when you walk? Do you you just let him?
Yeah, we do. We do, because we see the state of affairs and we know the future is bleak, so if it ends, it ends. I mean, that is one good thing about knowing that the future is is that, you know, as you you just go into more and more danger and, you know, hope that the pain will soon be ceased.
It must be interesting to let a dog, in all seriousness, let the sense, because they're following a scent,
right? That's right. They're following a scent, yeah.
And do Basil and Charlotte agree on the scent that must be followed?
No, that is a difficulty, and we let Basil determine the path, because Charlotte is more malleable, whereas Basil, you know, once he gets his mind set on something. Well, me and my wife are actually thinking of writing, I mean, we have to get to it, but we're thinking of writing an animated show with Basil, and we call it Hunting Bin Laden's Dog, because of the way Basil walks on the street is hilarious. We think it would be so funny to film him walking, and he's just hearing from a commander. He's got a little earpiece in his ear, and it's like, Basil, you must go straight ahead. Bin Laden's dog. We have it, from our GPS unit and aerial photography. He's in the yard to your right, and then Basil just like will sit down under a tree. Basil, what are you doing? It's like, no, I'm just taking it right now. I want to rest. But Bin Laden's dog, and it's very funny. Anyway, this is how we.
What kind of dog is Basil?
He is. We had a DNA test run on him,
and he killed Nicole Simpson, and they freed OJ.
He turned out to kill Nicole Simpson with the DNA. Yes. No, he's what is he, honey? He's a Lapsa Opso and a Norwich Terrier.
He's a lapsed Apso. It's like a lapsed Catholic.
You know, that is a funny thing, by the way, when I'm working out. And my trainer has no clue that we are, you know, he's one of these guys who says all you have to do is think positively about life. And I point out that the oceans are rising, and he goes, you have to think positively. And I point out that 80% of people are in terror, in debt. And he says, you have to think positively. You have to see a golden ball of light. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and I then point out that we have the largest prison population in the world, and that, you know, we live in a police state, and, you know, what has happened to the African-Americans now happening to white middle-class and lower white middle-class people. And he says, please think positively and let, you know. So it's a weird relationship I have with the guy.
I think of it as positive. We're number one in anal rape.
Right.
We have more people behind bars. We're the leading country when it comes to anal rape. Here's the thing. I know you have to go. I know you have to go train.
Yeah.
And do you carry the escape hammer? Remember when for your birthday, when you turned 40, I bought you an emergency blanket and an escape hammer. Do you carry the escape hammer with you at all times? It'll break any type of window or glass.
Well, have you thought about that? You don't think there's going to be unrest. Do you think it'll just be a general rounding up, quietly rounding up?
No, I think we've already been rounded up. I think we're own prisoners.
You're right.
My Dinner with Andre. Did you ever see My Dinner with Andre?
I did, and he says we're the jailers and the warden.
Yes, and I think that's pretty much
what we... I have the My Dinner with Andre action figures. Now, by the way, that isn't my joke. That was in Christopher Guest's Waiting for Guffman at the end. They did all this really funny, like, little one-off things. And My Dinner with Andre action figures were hilarious.
My dinner with Andre ruined me because it came out, I think, like in the mid to early 80s. And I thought, this is what a movie should be. Just two guys talking.
I loved it. I loved it.
Me too. I loved it. It was just a...
Like you, we both love, which, you know, the Buddhists say is not great. We both love to, like, engage our minds and, like, chew on philosophical questions. Whereas the Buddha... and the religious people, the spiritual people, say we have to divorce ourselves from mind and ego, let that go, and kind of be taken into the womb. Maybe that's what my trainer means. Just let go of all this talk about how horrible. Maybe this is how we'll wind this up today. Instead of talking about the outer reality. Of the country, having, as you put it, we've lost already. Maybe our inner reality can be different, even if we're not doing well outer wise. What do you think of that?
I think that's true, and I think the lesson that I'm taking away from this conversation is we are communal animals. We need to be around other living things. And I find, listening to you, that the danger of people, being around people, this addiction to people is very isolating. That the more time I spend, when I'm face down in another human being, it's taking me away from what's really important in life. So I need to do a detox, a human detox, and stop being around people, because that's the real poison. More time on the phone. More time dealing with the...
I don't know. I don't know if you're getting the lesson right, but...
I love you, Eddie. I miss you.
I love you too, buddy.
When are you coming to New York?
I don't know. I don't have anything booked in New York.
Hey, we did a right live now. Show. We did a live taping of the podcast last
week.
Oh,
you did? Who did you have? Who did you have on it?
We didn't do... We had Sean Donnelly, Angela Cobb, and Pat Dixon. We did it at a QED. And I...
QED? Oh, in Queens?
Yes. And we didn't do it old school, Eddie. Remember, because you... were the reason I first started doing live podcasts.
Was it the live one I did in the apartment there?
No,
Alex's place.
It was kind of like that. It was just me talking to people. I would, but if you ever come back,
right.
I miss those big production numbers that we used to do.
Oh yeah! I can't believe that was the genesis of your podcast with you writing. And Steve Rosenfeld, I don't know where he is. Do you know where Rosenfeld is?
I don't know. And Jim Earle, those were some of the funniest things ever. And you know what? They're just sitting on the website. People can find them. They're just, you have to...
Oh, man. They were insane.
But you just have to...
They were insane.
They were so... Let's, before you go, tell me about Gary Shapiro. Yeah. Wasn't he
great? Yeah, sweetheart of a guy, very funny, and died suddenly a couple of days ago. Kind of a shocking thing. What were your memories?
He was a perfect human being. He was a rabbi.
Yeah.
He was a comedian, a songwriter, a comedy writer, and a musician. There wasn't anybody on the planet who had a bad word to say about Gary Shapiro.
That's very true.
Except you and me.
You and I. Yeah, well, I have issues with everyone.
No, he was...
His sweetheart, right?
Yeah, yeah. All right. By the way,
also, we lost Don Rickles.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, I know you're a fan of him, right?
I love Don Rickles. I loved
it. I mean, he lived a nice long life, though. We just, who me and Karen went and saw? We saw Bob Newhart in the La Miranda Theater. We had to go south on the 5 to see Bob Newhart. And I thought he was going to look terrible or just be kind of wheeled out. And the guy looks great and was sharp as a tack. I think he's 90.
Good.
Amazing.
Good. That's
yeah.
good to know.
Yeah. All right.
All right.
Buddy,
I love you, buddy. Eddie Pepitone. We got to do this more often.
Yep. All right, Dave.
Give my love to Karen. Give my love to Charlotte, but not Basil.
Okay.
Bye.